Welcome to our art show, Ara Toi Pathways to Art. I am your host, Becky Bateman, here this week. Thank you, Sarah, so much for Sarah for subbing in for me last time as I had COVID. So thank you very much. And I work at the Ara Toi exhibition team. Now, if you are new to the show, Ara Toi Pathways to Art is all about art and museums and collections and exhibitions and artists and generally the wider Wairarapa area and their community. And the aim of the show is to help you understand art and museums. Every month on the first Tuesday of the month, we interview a selected artist or members of the Wairarapa cultural community and to delve a little bit further into their work. Joining us today on the phone is an artist called Jenny Keat. She is a Wellingtonian artist and she's currently exhibiting at Ara Toi in our beautiful Windows Gallery. So I'm going to give her a call, see if she's going to pick up, and we'll give her a chat. Here we go. Come on. Are you there, Jenny?
Hello,
Jenny. Becky speaking.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm very well. How are you?
I am very good. Now, you're live, so do not swear. That's what they say, isn't it?
Okay.
so lovely to have you joining us on the show this afternoon.
Well, thank you for inviting me. Delighted to be here.
You are welcome. So, Jenny, would you like to briefly introduce yourself to our listeners? Who are you and what do you do?
Well, I live in Wellington. I grew up in Auckland, and I've been painting for about 10 years. My background, my creative training is in design. I've got an industrial design degree from Victoria, and my initial creative work was in the field of, I made fiberglass lamps for a few years, and I've also worked as an industrial designer with a company called Morfitt. And they, I'm still a little bit involved with them, and we've got a ergonomic back support for people that get back pain driving. So anyone who's got that problem should look that up. And I still do a bit of that, but my creative work now is painting. So, and I switched from design to painting because after a few years of design, it just started to feel a little bit sort of fashion and consumer oriented for my liking. Yeah, I took up painting in a sort of, about 10 years ago. I took some classes at Inverlochy, which I highly recommend to anybody wanting some good instruction in painting technique. And in fact, lots of friends who went through art school have told me that they didn't learn a lot of the type of things that I learned there. So you can get some very good instruction at the community classes that are out there.
They are really good, those community classes. They're so valuable for people who don't know quite what they want to paint or quite what they want to do. But just giving that a little bit of instruction to try something new, I think is really valuable.
You need to paint a lot to work out what it is that you want to do as well. I mean, a lot of people starting out, and I was in this category, you sort of start out and you think, what is my style? And you find it really hard to answer that question, but you've just got to paint your way there.
Yes.
And it takes a long time. I think there was a famous trumpet player who said something like, it takes a long time before you sound like yourself. some jazz player, I'm not quite sure who said that, but yeah. Finding your own voice is a pretty long process. It takes a few hours, yeah.
And did you have a natural affinity to a particular type of painting? Did you like do watercolours or go, no, I don't really like those? Or did you suddenly go, oil, yep, I like that, or acrylic?
Yeah, well, I mean, I had been a sort of a hobby painter for off and on for years, and so I'd tried acrylics. My father was quite a busy watercolourist, so I hadn't done too much there, but I'd tried watercolours. But when I went to Inverlochy, what was being taught was oils. Mm-hmm. So I learned all these fantastic techniques, the Venetian painting technique, where you start with a sort of tonal underpainting and then you build up each layer of each colour one at a time. So you might, in fact, my first sort of painting project that I did was I painted every member of my family. I did their portraits.
Oh, yes.
Because nobody liked their portraits, which didn't surprise me.
No one ever likes their portraits.
No, exactly. That's an absolute loser's game. But it was just great technique. So you start with a layer of, I think it was burnt umber or something, and then go over that with blue, the classic blue to get the darks, and then you'd come in with the opaques as the last stage, and you end up with an incredibly realistic result, as long as you've got those other basics right, of course, your fundamental drawing. But yeah, so, but then after a few years of oils, I just felt like I was making just such a mess of oily rags, and so I kind of partly moved to acrylics because I just thought it might be a bit more environmentally friendly. And of course that's a bit of a mixed bag as well, because acrylic is plastic. But I'm just very careful to use, I don't wash my brushes out. I sort of clean the water before I discard it, and there's ways of filtering your own paint water before you pour it down the drain.
I hadn't really even thought about acrylic is actually plastic. And if you're just washing brushes just in the sink, where is that water going? That's a really interesting point.
It's actually going out probably to sea as a microplastic. So it is good to filter the paint out of your water before you let it into the...
I'm quite intrigued now. How do you filter your water?
I read about this product, Golden Paint Seller product, they call the Crash System, I think it is, and I haven't bought that, but I've just bought the chemicals that they use. So you just gather your paint water in a bucket. So every time my bucket's full, I will dissolve some, I think it's aluminium sulfate or magnesium sulfate. I could look that up. But anyway, anyone who looks up filter paint water, or Golden Crash System or something, I think it's aluminium sulfate, and it's a chemical you can buy at the garden centre. So you dissolve sort of maybe 20 grams or something of that into the water, swirl it round, and you really do see the paint particles just starting to sort of form into clumps.
Okay.
And then you dissolve some lime, garden lime, another garden centre product, and you add that into the water. And then if you leave it for a day or two, you have clear water in most of the bucket, and the rest is just sort of solid goo at the bottom that you still have to kind of like filter it through paper towels to separate the goo from the water. You can pour most of the clear water off the top, but then the last bit I just strain it through paper towels, and you end up with just sort of like a wadge of stuff that does go to the landfill, but the rest of it, at least you're not sending the plastic out to sea.
No, I've never heard of this. I'm so pleased that there's something you can do you are looking after the environment as you're painting. Because I know sometimes, as you say, people are very unaware of you're just washing brushes in the sink and you don't really think about it.
I know. Yes, and it's I think people could think a bit harder about that.
Oh, well, I've learned something already, Jenny. Thank you so much.
Good.
Now, your beautiful exhibition, Looking Sideways, it's such an interesting title. Can you give us a little hint of where that title came from? Because sometimes these titles they sometimes just appear, or sometimes they really tell quite a good story about the exhibition themselves.
Yeah, so I came up with the title before I had really had a very strong idea of what I was going to paint about, but I knew that that I was going to be looking at the Wairarapa. So the first thing I did was look up the meaning of the name, the place name, Wairarapa. And I understand that there are sort of different interpretations of that, but that the generally accepted meaning is glistening waters.
Yeah.
And then I looked up the word Rarapa came up with that search. And there are two possible meanings of that word, and one of which is sideways and another is to glance. And so the looking sideways comes from the Rarapa part of the word Wairarapa. And I just thought that it was a lovely expression in terms of putting a show together and thinking about, well, you don't necessarily want to look directly and hard at a subject. You sort of look around a subject, you know, you sort of want to take quite a broad, rather than, it describes an approach to painting for me, which is about not trying to depict what is actually in front of your eyes, but you just don't limit it to the current appearance of a thing, but you think, well, what was there before and what might be there after, and what are all the other stories around this place, rather than just what we see at present. So sort of like looking sideways, kind of, I thought, captured that approach to painting.
Yeah, it's a beautiful title, and it really does, now you explain it, and obviously I've seen the exhibition, it really does make a lot of sense. So well done on a good title, because sometimes a good title is hard to find.
Thank you. And then there was the rather funny sort of coincidence, really, that when I went up to Driving Creek, and that was nothing to do initially with this show, but I was up there as an artist in residence.
So hang on, Jenny, hang on. When you say artist in residence, because I'm sure some of our listeners might not know what an artist in residence is, can you quickly give us an overview of what happens when you're an artist in residence? Do you just kind of hang out at someone's house for 3 weeks, or, you know, what do you do on a residency?
In this case, so this is Driving Creek, which is Barry Brickell's pottery in the Coromandel. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Anyone can apply. I think it was initially just potters, but they've opened it up to other art forms, so writers and painters can go. Really what you get is just the right to be there. Okay. You take your own materials, but for that time you're living in an artist community, or if you're a potter, you'd be buying the clay and you'd have access to all of everything a potter could possibly need. But as a painter, really, all we were provided with was a room to work in. We were actually lucky to have that room. You couldn't be guaranteed a wonderful spot to work. So painters should probably look into it. Just check that the conditions will be right for them. But potters should absolutely line up and go, because it's amazing. So you were provided with accommodation, very basic accommodation. You'd probably liken it to a campground.
Okay.
And there was a communal kitchen, which had a nice big dining table where we would gather in the evenings and either eat our own meal or share a meal. And people were coming and going all the time. It wasn't sort of like some other group experiences where you start as a group and you finish with a group.
Yeah, I was just wondering.
It was a lot more less organised than that. Yeah,
I did wonder if you just had the same group and you were there for 3 months at the same time.
No,
people are kind of coming and going.
That would have in some ways been nicer. It was only 2 weeks. I think you can apply to go for four, or you can go for two or any part of four. I chose two because I just didn't really know quite what I was letting myself in for.
Yes.
And on the application form it says you can, you know, that residency is for a month, but if you want to do it in two lots of 2 weeks, then say that on your form. So that's what I opted in for at the time, and it was a good length of time for me. It actually rained the whole time, so by the end of 2 weeks I was ready to come home.
Yeah, and wet. It needs some dry clothes. Well, that sounds really interesting. Who were you up there with?
A friend of mine just happened to have applied at exactly the same time. So I was there with my friend, the art teacher, Janya Bates.
Oh, yeah.
And we were both painting in the same studio. But there were a few potters there. But I'm not all that well hooked into the pottery community. So it wasn't really a cohort of people. I mean, we met some lovely people. But, some people actually, I realised, were applying as a group. So when we were about to leave, there was another bunch coming in that had actually applied to be there together, and that would be quite a good way to do it.
Yeah, I imagine the conversations.
Well, you'd want a mixture of new people, and but it was nice to have a friend there, that's for sure.
Oh, definitely. I imagine the conversations around that big dining table were quite interesting, night after
they
night.
They were. We probably shouldn't go into that.
Okay, moving away. Moving quickly, swiftly on. Now, if you can actually see on Wairarapa, the ROFM station on the TV, I've actually put up a picture of Jenny Keats' exhibition in its entirety, so you can actually see what we're talking about. And you can see along this beautiful long wall that we call the Windows Gallery, there's four small paintings from your time at Barry Brickell's place, and then you've got your 10 other pictures from the exhibition that you actually kind of included in this one. Do you want to tell us a little bit about those four paintings as we talk about Barry Brickell anyway? We might as well start off with those four beautiful smaller works at the end of the gallery, because they're quite interesting. I think When I first saw your work, these are the ones that I saw, and I was like, oh, this is quite interesting and different, because there's lots of trees and lots of eyes, and it was something I'd never really seen much of before.
Yeah, so, well, it was a funny coincidence that I had called the exhibition Looking Sideways. And then when I was up there, one of the amazing things about Driving Creek is that it is set in a regenerating kauri forest. So when Barry bought the land in the 1970s, it had been used for farming and it had been through several hundred, a couple of hundred years of logging, mining, and farming. And so it was clay, a clay hilly block. And he wanted the clay for his pottery, so that suited him well. And there were a few pines and macrocarp was there, but it was really just sort of like a bare, fairly unproductive farm block. And over the course of 30 years, he planted something like 23,000 trees. And so it's now a really quite mature piece of bush. And the trees that only take 50 years to grow are full size, so it feels quite lush. But there's all these trees that will one day be forest giants, kauri and Tanikaha, and they had the most amazing eyes on them. And so I started putting these eyes into my paintings because I'd never quite, I mean, lots of trees have, the eye is created when a branch falls and you get some scarring around as the tree kind of like heals that spot and I guess just closes itself up and makes sure it doesn't get bugs entering and things. These eyes were more distinctive than any other kind of eyes I'd noticed on trees before. And I was also quite struck because we were also walking in the forests off the property, and you walk amongst the giant kauri trees, and they don't have these eyes on them. So it really is a young tree thing. And so I kind of started to imagine that these young trees were kind of like watching me as I, because I walked in, I took a lovely walk up the railway track because Barry put a railway in this, it was his other passion, pottery, rail, and ecology.
A strange mixture, but yes.
Yeah, so I walked, yeah, very, very eclectic, but passionate about all of them. So yeah, it was just these eyes were everywhere, and it was fun to put them in the paintings because it just felt, I don't know, just sort of like adding that other dimension to a tree, which I didn't want to anthropomorph foes or affize, however we say that. I didn't want to kind of like say they're human because the eyes didn't, they look like bird eyes if anything, but something about putting that little hint of sentience onto a tree is to say that these are lives, at least at the very least, that have great value. And when you're in a place like the Coromandel where the forest has been largely removed, it was just so lovely to be in this place where was coming back and it's protected in perpetuity. So you knew that this place was, really on the way back to a lovely, healthy, original condition. So those first four paintings, I started, so I've got the trees with eyes, but I also started putting this little figure into them because Barry's presence up there is very strong. Even though he died in 2016, a lot of the rooms are kind of like left as he set them up. Like our studio was opposite his old pottery studio, and that just looks like he walked out, well, some time ago. It's all dusty, but his stuff is just everywhere there. Like there's pottery all through the bush. So as you're walking through this bush, not only are the trees looking at you, but there's just pottery everywhere. I started in my paintings wanting to kind of get that human presence into them because the presence of these nice, what feel like really benign human presence because they were, bringing the bush back, and also there's rats and possum traps everywhere, and really the people are looking after the place, and it's a lovely thing. And so I wanted to put in this little kind of like hint of Barry or just an ecologist, and I came across a cross section of a railway track. And I think that appears in a couple of those paintings. So if you think of what a railway track would look like if you cut straight down through it and then took a little segment out of it, it sort of comes out like a head and neck and shoulders. And these little segments of the track. There were quite a few of them kicking around up there. And so I propped one up in my studio, and after a few days I realised, oh, that looks like a little head. So I started putting that into the paintings. Yeah, so that's where that shape comes from.
And I've noticed that shape in a couple of your paintings. So not even just the Barry Brickell ones, but actually all the way through.
Yeah, well, I snuck the shape into kind of late in the series into the Wairarapa ones that I did, because for me it started to symbolise the sort of the human, the people that are making such efforts towards, healing and healing the land, really, bringing the trees back and so on, looking after the river. Yeah.
And I love that this little figure, even though it's just a very simple, looks like a square with, like you say, a neck, you can really imagine it as a person, this kind of, this onlooker just looking what's going on in the background.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I also kind of liked it that it had a little hint of the Michael Illingworth shape, those characters that he used to put into
his
paintings.
Yes, it does, doesn't it? I haven't actually seen that before, but yeah, you're quite right. It does have a very familiar, similar shape to that. I'm not going to look at them. I'm going to look at them in a different way now.
Now, and funnily enough, it was on my last day at Driving Creek. My friend Janya said, "Oh, have you seen that poster outside the kitchen?" It was a poster from a painting that Barry Brickell had done, because in his last few years he took up painting and writing, and he had used this little shape as a head and shoulders. I haven't seen many of his paintings. I think he probably used it quite a lot. So that was initially I thought, oh God, I've just accidentally copied him. It's kind of nice because, I don't know. Don't have to be the first person to do something.
Yes, and it's almost like he's living on through these paintings, through that little shape.
That would be a nice thought, because his presence, as I say, is just such a lovely thing up there that you do feel that you that he's got your back, because he's sort of set this up for artists, and he's set up the woods that they will be there and thrive and into a perpetuity. And yeah, it's a lovely place for that.
So at the beginning you said that you have normally artists or potters, but can anybody apply to go up there to kind of help out, or is
they certainly probably want people to help out. But writers can go, but I would encourage people just to look at what sort of, I just thought some of the rooms, the natural light and the heating, they're still kind of working on making it super comfortable and suitable. I mean,
you're painting quite a picture.
I just don't go expecting it to be like a resort. That's all I'd say.
Yes.
I knew that it was going to be basic, and it was. But, in many ways, it's an absolutely magical place. But I spoke to the pottery manager before I got there. I was trying to work out what I was letting myself in for. And he said, some people come here and they either see magic or they see a mess. So you just want to be a person that go. And he said, and don't come along with too many expectations. It's kind of a case of take us as you find us.
Yeah.
And yeah, if you're just open to what might happen there, it's a magic place. And it certainly was good for me, because it really just kind of got me started on this whole theme of, I mean, I hadn't really specifically painted on the subject of ecological restoration. And once I started, it just felt really good.
I can imagine.
Because, you spend a lot of time fretting about what's happening, all the bad stuff. But so to be painting about what people were doing to mitigate all of that, it just felt really good.
And it's a very optimistic show, isn't it? And I think we'll talk about that more in a minute, because we're going to have a pause for our first music section. And this one, you may want to quickly introduce this one for us, Jenny, but this one's from Buffy St. Marie. Is that how you pronounce it? Would you like to tell us a little bit about, well, I'm afraid I can't speak French, so you might have to introduce it yourself, because it's in French, and tell us maybe a little bit about why you chose it.
Yes, well, I can't speak French either.
We'll both murder the language together.
Saskatchewan. I chose it because, I've just had a long love affair with the song. When I was a student flatting in Dunedin, I flatted with a musician, and he had a very, very good record collection, in a really giant stereo in his tiny bedroom, and every now and then he would just wind up the stereo and play. He had a few favourite songs. This was one. So every now and then in this flat, this song would just absolutely kind of be like bringing the house down. And I just loved it right from the start. And then at the end of that year, when he and all his records moved out, I realised that all I knew was that it had this this kind of like chorus that we'll all hear, and that it was by Buffy St. Marie, but it was kind of, it was before the days of the internet. So when I went to look for the song later, I just couldn't find it. So for years I thought, oh God, I love that song, and if only I could find it. But I think that the record had never been digitized, so it was just a song from an LP.
Yeah.
I didn't know the name of the LP. So for years I couldn't find it. Then probably about 10 years ago, I Googled it and found it again. And it was just like, you know, a lovely reunion. But the thing that I thought made it suitable for this show was that it's really a song about, well, there's a couple of things. It's about home, and the love of home and the land. And it's also about she says, you can travel all alone or you can come along with me. And I thought that was a nice, that sort of ties into the work that Māori Oho do with their Ruamahanga restoration work along the banks of the river. So we can come to that, but basically they're trying to bring the community along in this project to help the river get back into a better, healthy state.
Fabulous. Well, I'm looking forward to listening to this. So here we go.
Great.
Here's the song.
Okay.
See what you all think. Yeah, that was beautiful. I really enjoyed that.
Great. It's really an unusual piece of music, isn't it? You can see why I remembered it all those years later.
Yes, it's very unusual. I like that it's very upbeat, isn't it? So, I really quite enjoyed that. Thank you for sharing that with us. Now, I thought this next part, we would talk about the Ruamahanga River and this part of your exhibition that you've kind of added onto your Barry Brickell work at the beginning. And I've just got another picture. So if you are on the Wairarapa TV, you'll be able to have a look at some of these ones that I've popped up now. And you can kind of see that shape again that we were talking about of the figure, but also this beautiful river kind of in every single piece. Would you like to tell us a little bit about your inspiration for this body of work?
Yeah. When I was planning for this show, and I had started, I had the Barry Brickell paintings sort of done, or the idea in mind anyway. But I knew that the show was, I wanted to have something along the theme of ecological restoration still, but it to be based in the Wairarapa. So I went Googling terms like, or just that, ecological restoration, Wairarapa. And I read all about, most of the stories seem to relate to Ruamahanga and the Wairarapa Moana, and the stories about how it used to be a flooding of the river, and the lake used to be a time of plenty, and the Māori would have a great eel harvest, and then farming meant that those floods were prevented, and, you know, the health of the river has suffered, and of course that people, you know, the ability to harvest the eels is gone. And so it seemed to have this rather sad history. And as I kept reading, I started finding these stories about how people were working to bring the health of the river back. And I came across the Ruamahanga Restoration Trust website and read a little bit about their various replanting projects, mainly, I think, involving children. Mm. And I still kind of didn't know how to tackle the subject, though. And then I read a blog post on that website, which was an interview with Jane Ridderford, and she is a member of a family that own a farm just out of Martinborough, and it's on the banks of the Ruamahanga River. And she talked about how, well, she had lived overseas in London for several years, and she was doing ecological restoration, sort of a city forest or something project over there. And she would be thinking about her farm and really feeling the need to do something to help the river alongside which their farm. And it's got an oxbow on it, which is a place where the river used to flow, but now is kind of like naturally, they're often called an oxbow lake, but their oxbow had been grazed and was little more than a ditch. And so when she came back with her husband Rod and got together with her sisters, and they formed a plan to restore the health of their oxbow. And so it was fenced, and they excluded stock and started planting it. And so that's the project that I decided to focus on, because it was just such a small and manageable and really quite lovely example of the types of things that people are doing up and down the river. I think there's a lot of this type of work where people are really looking after their remnant blocks. We went and did a planting session at the Wairarapa bush. That's a beautiful Kiwi 2 protected remnant also on the river. That's kind of a story of how I got involved with that project. So all of these paintings are, they're just inspired along that theme, really focusing on the river. So you said that, the river winds through many of them. In some cases it's sort of charges through like a water highway, because I was trying to, I guess, show the different, the changing land use from how it's been to how it is to how it might be.
And I love the colours you've chosen. They're really these beautiful greens and these quite beautiful kind of grey blues. Did you kind of take those colours out of the landscape, or did you just kind of think, oh, that's kind of the colour of the Wairarapa, they need to be in there? Or did you just kind of see all these beautiful greens when you were kind of taking your sketches and kind of thinking about this exhibition?
Yeah. I mean, both I have the sort of work period for this exhibition did span quite a lush time of year.
Because it rained a lot.
Everything was quite green. I mean, when I've done other series, like with a Central Otago, or, you know, if you're painting in the summer or down south or something, the colours will be quite different. Mm. So I do tend to, I mean, I like, even though colour is a wonderful element to use abstractly, you sort of do want the paintings to speak, I mean, I do, about the place that they're about, because they are about place. So I'll often just take the colours from the landscape, but then sort of exaggerate them, really, rather than trying to replicate them. You know, because at some point it's just a, it's just sort of an ongoing sort of back and forth between reality and what the painting wants.
It certainly does feel like it's very much Wairarapa colours. You know, you could never have, you go and have a look at the exhibition, you know that that's what you're looking at, with it, especially with the tararuas in the background of most of them, and that such vivid green that we all know when it comes to the winter and the autumn, when you have that real vivid green on the hills all around. I mean, it's just beautiful, and it really does say Wairarapa so loudly, at least to me.
Oh, I'm pleased to hear that, given that I'm from Wellington, and so you always hope that you capture something of the spirit of a place, especially if you don't actually live there. So that's nice to hear.
So there's one particular painting that I really, really love, and I'm a big gutter, it's already sold, rats, and that's called Carrying the Memories, of this beautiful, this river kind of in the foreground of just whooshing by, and then this beautiful tall tree, I'm not quite sure what tree it is, but this beautiful just singular tree kind of reaching up to the sky. And I was like, that's so, it's sad and beautiful at the same time. You know, this tree's all by itself. Is it the last one?
Yeah.
And this, the title, Carrying the Memories, it's quite evocative.
That's a kahikatea tree.
Ah, okay.
And I painted that after a visit to Carter Scenic Reserve. And in fact, the person who bought that recognised that that's where it was, In fact, it's an imagined scene. So, for those of you who know Carter Scenic Reserve, you know, it's a wetland walk, boardwalk mostly, and you can walk down to the river, and I did. And then there is sort of like a hilly backdrop, but then as you're walking around the boardwalk, there are these kahikatea trees, and that actually, it's pretty true to life, even though it just looks mad, this tree just rising up above everything else. But
yes,
what that tells us is that when that tree grew up, it had to punch its way through a canopy. So now, you know, it's old, but it will be, but not exactly thriving, because it doesn't have all that, you know. Kahikatea actually like to grow in groups.
I was going to say, that makes it even sadder, doesn't it? That is completely all by itself, and you know, those trees do like to be in a group. And now it's almost like the last one, you know, the last one standing.
And I mean, it's sort of bittersweet experience walking around that reserve, because a lot of the trees are dying because of just changing water use. And it's been happening for, you know, decades. But it's an incredible place for anyone that hasn't been there.
It is.
And
now, you've done something very clever with your titles, Jenny, which I really, really like. You've actually used the titles of each one into a poem. Do you have the poem on you? Do you remember the poem?
I could probably
put you on the spot.
Well, I think I probably do remember. Would you like me to read it out?
Oh, go on then, if you've got it to hand.
Okay. I don't think I do have it to hand, but I think I can probably remember it. In the young forest, I felt watched. The visionary looking sideways. Closer to home, I found a river in a state of restoration. Diverted, crossed, meandering, maybe that's slightly the wrong order. I found sentinels carrying the memories, dreaming on a time to come. And so, that's an idea I had a while ago, before this show. I thought, wouldn't it be cool if I could run the titles of these paintings together into a piece of text that sort of still read as a piece of text, but each title worked. But at the time, I just couldn't make the idea work in terms of the show I was doing at the time. But then for this show, because there was a story, it just sort of, it came together. And yeah. I was really pleased with that.
It works really well, actually. Yeah. I really like it. And you can see which the title of each one really does represent the picture. Like when you said the visionary. And again, it's one with the trees with the eyes. And yeah, it's just a really clever way of doing it. I was really, I really enjoyed that when you said that that's something you wanted to do. And it kind of works really well here. Like you say, it kind of tells this beautiful story. So before we move on, Jenny, I think it's probably time for a second song break, amazingly. We are whizzing through. It's already got 20 minutes left, incredibly.
Okay.
So this next one is Kai Tempest and Salt Coast. Do you want to have a quick tell us about this one? Because this is one I've not heard of either. You'll give me two new things to listen to today.
Great. Okay. Well, I love this song. I saw Kai Tempest perform in Wellington earlier this year, and I had listened to the album. I heard them interviewed on Kim Hill, and that's where I sort of how I discovered them. And this song, I just found it so moving, because to me it seemed to be talking about the love of a place and the eternity of the land, and then you've got all these human concerns sort of swirling around in amongst that, affecting the land, maybe just swirling around in your head, but against the backdrop of this, just the primal force of this place, Salt Coast. It's just, I found it a very powerful song, and seeing it live was incredible. So I think I'm not necessarily doing the song justice. Apparently it's about their love of their home country, England, but let's just have a listen and see what people think.
Let's have a listen. I think onto that, let's press play.
To chalk at your edges. I love the way you fade into a sky that is as endless as your willingness to try. Keep going, and it will get better. I love the way you push to get clear. I love the way you dance to get strong. Ancient, slick clay, rock formed, wet sand, moss born. What came before, and what will come after? Beneath the orderly cues, the bad moods, the nice views, the have-nots and have-tos, the night shifts in flat shoes, the discarded masks, the empty tubes, the colds, the flus, the reds, the blues, the buy-to-let, the play-to-lose, the white ace, the grey goose, the Michelin star, the fast food, the straight lies, the strange truth. I can hear the deep rasp of your laughter, joyful. Beneath the stifled resentments and microaggressions, all part of the fabric, the tension woven so tight it defies its dimension. The see, but don't feel. The know, but don't mention. There you are. Hedonistic, self-destructive, insecure. Trying to get away from the mistakes you made before. Salt Coast, foul wind, old ghosts, scrap tin. Leaves, rain, leaves, rain, Salt Coast, foul wind, old ghosts, scrap tin. Veering in knowledge. I appreciate your efforts, acknowledging your privilege, but prone to backstepping. Sure, it's not by our past that our future will be measured. It's by the very moment that we're slumping in disheveled, 6 hours into some TV show that tastes like the feeling of pizza. I know what you reach for, all dressed up with nowhere to go, benched, waiting for a path to open up, waiting for a thing that might make you old enough to get into the pub where people drink to lost youth. I see you scraping the gravel in your Air Max, so beautiful, so chaotic, so grounded. Home, concrete and loam, brick dust and loans, wood floors, screen doors and a place of your own. Pay it off the rest of your life, but who's asking? Restless, the damp night approaching, distilling the heat, too long on your feet, now you want to be free from the strain of what's done in your name. Every single inch of you is somebody's claim, the familiar refrain of their glory and your shame. You just want to keep moving, the energy contained is spilling out and making trouble for you. Nothing is the same. You got out from underneath the weight of suffer and obey, the tyranny and hate of Britannia rules the waves, and now you swing your hips as you go strutting down the lane. I love you when I see you this plain. Your salt coast, your foul wind, your old ghost, your scrap tin, the browning of your leaves and the greening of your rain. Salt coast, foul wind, old ghost, scrap tin, leaves, rain, leaves, rain. Salt coast, foul wind, old ghost, scrap tin, leaves, rain, leaves.
I really like that. I found my leg great. Tapping quite happily to, along to that, and thinking how yes, that does remind me a lot about England and the rain, especially. Yeah. But that was really lovely. Thank you very much for sharing that with us. That was a really lovely one. Thank you. I thought we would just finish up because amazingly we've only got 10 minutes left of the show, and there's you and I thinking we would be able to talk for an hour. And I thought we would chat quickly about your work with the school children. Because actually in your exhibition, you've brought in two pieces of work that you have done with the school children. They're on the kind of the back wall of the Windows Gallery. And they've got some of these beautiful poems on. I thought you just might like to tell us a little bit about these two pieces of work and how you're getting on with working with the schools.
Yeah, so that came about through the project that I got involved with, the Māori Oho project. So the members of the group there, the Ritterford, Jane Ritterford and Rod and the sisters, but mainly Jane and Rod are the Martinborough-based people, they run these community planting days. So they really are all about getting the community involved, and they also work with school children. So I've been involved in a couple of planting experiences with the kids from maybe about 15 children from Featherston School. And then we've been planting in the Wahinga bush, and then the second planting was in the wetland at Ruamahanga Farm. And then after those planting sessions, Jane and Rod will go in and do a bit of creative work with the kids to really get them to think a bit more deeply about the experience and cement it, I think, into their minds. And so the creative writing work they did after the Wahinga bush planting, I think about six children, and they each wrote a reasonably long little piece, like maybe 100 words. And they were encouraged to think about imagining themselves as a seed waiting in the bush for the conditions to be the right to be right for them to sprout. And they wrote these incredibly poetic and beautiful statements. I was amazed. Not that I mean, of course, I know children are capable of wonderful things, but I thought the writing was incredibly beautiful.
It really is. And it's very poignant. Is,
and then I took a sentence. I just made sure each child had a little bit of their work included, or else there would have been too much to put everyone's work in. And so those two paintings, they take sort of a phrase from each of the children who took part, and they're again woven into sort of like kind of slightly poetic story statements about, well, that experience of just imagining, you know, just sort of being in the bush, but really from the perspective of the tree, which is rather lovely given where this whole exhibition has sort of come from and going to. And then we've also run an art workshop with them. So after their wetland experience, last week we went to Hoariki Marae in Martinborough, and they were encouraged to sort of imagine themselves back in the bush. Rod, who's a former primary school teacher, sort of got them into the mode of really imagining themselves back there. And then we got them to paint with bearing that in mind, but not telling them what to paint. And I got them to use all sorts of different painting tools so that they couldn't sort of get straight into kind of like if there was something that they already know that they can do. They did paint quite experimentally. It was good. And I limited their palette just to keep things fairly tidy and so that what we put up will kind of work with my show. So I've got all these little pieces from them that I'm going to – I've sort of – come up with a bit of a composition of all these different pieces, and we're going to add that to the wall hopefully later this week. So yeah, it's been a wonderful thing to see these kids, lots of them planting a tree for the first time and saying, oh, I love this, I'm good at it.
And how wonderful to get children involved as well, because you know, if they get that kind of thing from an early age and love it, and they realise they have to respect the river and look after the land, then that's something they're going to take the rest of their lives.
That's the idea. Because, as Jane was saying, a lot of the people that get involved with tree planting, you know, they're in their 60s. And you really need to get everybody interested. It's no good just the older people.
Yes.
Taking part in this.
And did you say it was just Featherston School, or was it a mixture of schools?
So far just Featherston, because it's fairly new. I mean, Jane and Rod only came back from England a few months back, so they're just sort of picking up steam on this type of work. Yeah.
Okay, and what are they planting? Any particular types of tree?
Well, I mean, just things that are sort of appropriate. So to the spot where we are. So in the wetland, all of the kids got to plant a kahikatea.
Okay.
And the rest of what we were planting that day was grasses. But basically anything, just all of these different swamp, you know, it's a riparian type, I guess, is the...
And I think a lot of people don't realise how important wetlands are they? Because, you know, you think of climate change, you think we need to plant more forests. But actually, wetlands, they soak up so much carbon and kind of keep it locked in that kind of peaty, swampy soil.
I think they sort of have a great big role in cleaning, keeping the river clean and all sorts. And I believe that the Wairarapa has lost something like 90-something% of its wetlands. I mean, basically, in its natural state, there would be a heck of a lot of wetland cover. So it's lovely to see people starting to look after these places and just let them do what they want to do naturally.
Yes, rather than interfering.
Yeah, I mean, just excluding the stock on this place has meant, and fencing it, has meant that a lot of what wants to be there is coming back.
Good.
You don't have to plant these plants necessarily. The seeds just hang around waiting for the conditions to be right.
I mean, it's such an optimistic show, and so nice to hear you say that, because you do sometimes think, maybe it's just me, maybe you do sometimes think that everything's so doom and gloom and it's never going to work, or it's never going to happen, or we're stuck with this horrendous kind of cycle of events now that we've kind of initiated. But it's so lovely to hear you say that there's something positive.
I really feel for kids growing up with all this worry you know, growing up, and they're just having such different sort of conditions forming than we did. Where in my case, we just didn't have this worry. I mean, litter, sort of like don't litter, was the kind of environmental message.
Yeah. Yes.
So, and I think that, I mean, art that you know, dystopia is not an inspirational sort of concept, and a lot of future people. I mean, you know, when you do something, you want people to be encouraged to act. And I think that optimism and hope is a much stronger motivation for action than sort of despair, which is how you feel if you just only hear about the bad news. So that's why it feels good to me to be at the end of things, and also just like act locally, you know, because the world's problems are too big to solve.
Yeah.
But just, you know, here we've got a river that if you plant a tree, it'll do something. So it's just nice to feel that you can do something, and to celebrate the people that are doing something.
Yeah, and even something small like planting a tree, if everyone does something small, it ends up to be pretty big, doesn't it? I mean, you shouldn't be disheartened just because you're like, oh, I've just planted a tree. But actually, even those small steps, those small little actions, they all kind of come together and actually make a huge difference. So if anybody is listening who's been worrying about, oh, maybe I should do something, well, just go ahead. Tell us about the restoration, Mori Oho, is it? The Restoration Trust?
Yeah, they have planting days, probably monthly, but I think they've got two coming up in August.
Okay, so people can get hold of them.
People can. And so their website is ruamahanga.org.nz. They've got planting days on August the 13th and the 20th of this month, 10 till 1.
Fabulous.
I mean, the Ruamahanga Restoration Trust also probably is another place where people can get involved, and they do great work. And I think maybe they work more with school kids, I'm not sure. Mm. So, fully encourage people to take part in those planting days. We've been to one. It was a lovely community experience.
I bet.
You know, met lots of interesting people, and just you just feel like you're doing something good.
Yeah. Well, on that nice positive note, should we say goodbye, Jenny? And thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. It's been so lovely to talk to you and have you to myself for an entire hour to talk about your fabulous exhibition. Now, it's called Looking Sideways. It's in Ara Toi. It's on until the 27th of August. So you've got another, just over 3 weeks to go and check it out. It is really beautiful. And the work is for sale. And, you know, that's always really good to be able to promote some artists and have some work being sold as well. So if you are up in the area, do come and have a little look. But thank you so much to Jenny for spending the time with us this afternoon and for giving me two new pieces of music to listen to.
Lovely. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye, Jenny. So that was Jenny, Jenny Keat. Absolutely fabulous. So I do highly recommend going to see this exhibition. Thank you again for listening today. To Ara Toi Pathways to Art. And if you have missed any of them over the last couple of months, I think this might be number 5 that we've done, you can actually go and download the podcast from the Arrow FM website and go and listen again. And we've had some fabulous guests. We had Leah Creven at the beginning of the year with her beautiful rugs. We had a good chat to Ian Chapman, who's with King Street Artworks as well. He was a fabulous guest talking about mental health and art. We have Bex Johnson, and she was talking a lot about the master murals and how they came about. And then last month, we had Sarah stepping in for me, talking to the fabulous Gareth Winter, who is just a knowledge-filled person about the Master Museum and all those beautiful objects that we had on display. Thank you again very much for listening, and I will see you, or talk to you again, next month. Bye, all.